India has got with it some good news, some bad news. Bad news when it comes to Omicron, also a bit red, as we've been saying it, on the global crypto market as well. They've suffered a lot in the past couple of days. Yesterday, the crypto markets, in fact, saw a massive sell-off by over 6.5% or so with just 24 hours, taking the total market cap to $2.07 trillion, really. Now, until a short while back, top cryptos like Bitcoin, Ethereum, they had all declined around 3%, 7% over the past 24 hours. Popular meme coins like Doge, Shiba also dipped. Other major coins, the BNB, Solana, Cardano, XRP, all have seen a sharp decline in the market. Also, in the last 24 hours, the DeFi sector seemed to have taken a slump as well. The metaverse, however, is in the green. Now, why has this happened? It's basically because of two news items that have really dominated the market as well and the psyche of the people. One is, of course, what happened in the United States. The sell-off has come in response to U.S. Federal Reserve indications of raising the interest rates. They're also planning to stop printing money, which will eventually make it more expensive to borrow in order to steady the economy. On the other hand, for crypto per se, Kazakhstan, the country known as the crypto world for accounting almost 18% of Bitcoin network's hash activity, they saw a nationwide internet shutdown. Now, are these two the only factors why market has dipped the way they have? Well, that's something we will be discussing with our experts now. So let's bring them on. Joining us today is Arun. He's the co-founder for Mohash. Also back with us on CC is Ajit Khurana, the founder of Genesis Network. Ajit and Arun, welcome to CC. Happy New Year to you guys as well. But not so happy news coming our way when it comes to the crypto markets. Arun, let's begin with you. And if you could state for our viewers your top two reasons on why markets are behaving the way they are.
You got the reasons bang on. It's basically the chatter within the Federal Reserve that maybe they would consider pulling liquidity out of the market. It is one of the options on the table they're considering. That is pretty much the primary reason. You could see that when crypto prices crashed, public markets also crashed in a substantial way in the last 2-3 days. So that's pretty much the dominant reason. The Kazakhstan thing could have had some impact on the Bitcoin price. That is one way to think about it. But broadly, you saw that in last year when China shut down mining last year, the prices of Bitcoin didn't get materially affected during that time because the transition was well managed when most of the miners moved from China to United States and other countries. So Federal Reserve remains the dominant reason, in my view.
I see. Ajit, is that your view as well? I'm just trying to understand, you know, every time we've seen a shakeup in the way US is behaving, every time we've seen a shakeup perhaps in the stock market as well, are there any particular trends one needs to relate to when it comes to the crypto markets? Top two reasons for you?
I hate to perpetuate market superstitions, but the fact is that barring in 2020, January has always been a bad year for crypto. In fact, just 1 year ago, the crypto market or Bitcoin prices fell from 40,000 to 30,000, which is a 25% fall. We are currently at 20 for this fall. But having said that, despite what every guru in every market says, the one correlation between even non-correlated markets is liquidity. So even the impending lack of reduced liquidity by printing money, I think, is disaster for all markets, to be honest. And because the beta of the crypto markets is much higher, volatility is much higher, so crypto markets will suffer the most. I must point out that changes in mining, changes in number of miners, location of miners, etc., tends to have close to zero effect based on the algorithm, which adjusts itself within minutes, I should at least almost within hours. So the Kazakhstan factor, I don't think, is a factor at all.
Right. I mean, China actually is a classic example of that, of what Ajit is saying as well. Let me go back to Arun then. Arun, there is also a significant increase in the number of addresses holding Bitcoin from 1,000 to 10,000 Bitcoins between December beginning to December end. What does that tell us about the majority holdings over here? And what does that tell us about the ability of Bitcoin to recover also as this sort of wave comes in?
The number of addresses could be a function of a long-term secular growth and retail participation in crypto. While you can say there's a bear market, or we can have all the conversations around, oh, there's a big slump, there is fundamental belief in the idea that crypto is digital gold. That's been proven over and over again for about 11 years now. People are not, a Bitcoin investor is not shaken by the volatility that is attributed to that. So it's like long-term trends are more favorable. That's a likely reason. But I'm not a market expert, but these are just data that's clearly available in the public domain. I'm just presenting it. Yeah.
Okay. And your thought on how actually is there a pattern? Is there a trend in which stock markets versus crypto markets actually behave every time there is a global news of this magnitude?
So there are useful indicators for us to look at. If you look at India, NASDAQ and crypto data. So what happened as a response to COVID was Federal Reserve increased its balance sheet from about $3 trillion to north of $8 trillion. That's more than 2x in liquidity as a response to COVID. Directly, what happened was Apple, which is a pretty, I mean, we know it's pretty amongst the best companies in the world. Its PE used to trend between 15 to 25 and it started trending at 45. Right. Everyone's PE ratio started doubling. I mean, roughly even well-run companies and higher risk assets multiplied more. Bitcoin went up 5x, Ethereum went up 20x and all of that stuff. So liquidity directly went way more into high risk assets. And that still remains the dominant reason for all this growth.
I see. Interesting. Ajit, I want to come to you on the other factor that we discussed in the opening as well, the hash rate. And, you know, there's a bit of a flip-flop here because one doesn't know how to read this news. The hash rate of Bitcoin has actually reached an all-time high. And that's good news for the network, right? And for those of our viewers who don't understand, a hash rate is actually, just understand this, the higher the hash rate, higher overall network integrity, meaning the network now stands stronger than before. But investors seem to have not noticed that at all. And the news has been all about what happened in Kazakhstan.
So, you know, hash rate to a Bitcoin network is like GDP is to a nation.
Yes.
However, as we would agree that GDP, while an important indicator, the per capita or the distribution of GDP probably is more important. So what we are seeing in some of the bigger coins is that while the hash rate is increasing, it is also getting concentrated, which is against the ethos of the decentralization. This indicates why the majority of people, not necessarily the richest people, but the majority in terms of number of people are not necessarily reacting identically. And I must throw in one more point about correlating this with the addresses. While number of people are increasing in the Bitcoin as well as other cryptocurrency markets, there is a concept in wallets, and I hate to throw jargon here, which is called a heuristically determinant address, where what people are now doing is that every time they transact, they create a new address, as opposed to having an address which they use forever. And that is also causing an abnormal increase in the number of addresses.
I see. All right. So we got to tabulate sort of all of that. I have last 30 seconds, quick buy or sell call on Bitcoin from both of you. Ajit, you can go first.
Unlike your jacket, which is red in color, I will go with my file folder, which is green in color. And I think while there may be some more pain, I hate to time the market. But if you haven't yet entered the market, this is a good time to start averaging in.
Okay, Arun, your call.
Long-term buy for Bitcoin and Ethereum. The data is quite clear. They're following Lindy effect. Something that's last longer will continue to last longer.
So, all right. All right, let's see. Is it going to dip further? And then we can go back to these gentlemen and say, how did you actually make that conclusion? Well, that's the time we have on the program. Thank you, Arun and Ajit, for joining us.